It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for having me. Let's kick off. Okay. I want to talk to you about the future of humanity, but we'll ease our way in gently, softly. Consider this. We derive meaning from context. We derive meaning from context. Okay? Yeah? What do I mean by that? Let me give you an example. How many of you would like to trade your bottle of smart water for this Rolex up here on the screen? Hand up. Yeah? Few people didn't understand the question, don't speak English. Very good. Okay? Very good. Right? Who wouldn't? I traded my bottle for a Rolex, now I've got it. Awesome. But think about this. Now I take you out of this context and I put you into the sub-Saharan desert. How many of you would trade your bottle of smart water for a Rolex? Right? Okay, we still have someone. At least you die rich. Very good. Okay. The point is, we derive meaning from our context. Why? Because the context provides us with the questions, okay, that allow us to answer three critical questions, provides us with the information that allows us to answer three critical questions that allow us to orientate ourselves. Question number one, what am I? Who am I? Okay, question number two, what's around me? And question number three, what's my position in this surrounding? And what are the ways that I can relate in there? Okay? And that's very important to understand that based on these questions, we derive not only meaning, but also purpose. Okay? Now, how we answer these questions depends on how much of the context that surrounds us we are aware of. How much of it I am aware of. Okay? There's a nice story about a scientist that went to Namibia to study a particular tribe there that did not have the word blue, the color blue in the vocabulary. Have you guys heard about this? This tribe doesn't have the color blue in the vocabulary, and they put little squares of colors in front of them. Some were green, some were blue, and they asked them to distinguish between the blue ones and the green ones. And the tribe could not distinguish. They have, however, a whole bunch of different words for green, and those scientists, the green cards they put out were meant to be all the same green color, but these guys could easily distinguish between the different shades of green because their perception, their radius of awareness, included all these different shades. Yeah? So, what's around me is the first question. The second question then is, how much of it do I actually see? That's our radius of perception and our radius of inclusion. And our radius of inclusion is affected by the assumptions and beliefs that we hold, the assumptions that we make and the beliefs that we hold, conscious and unconscious. Okay, let me give an example for this. This is a story that's been told and credited to Albert Einstein. I don't know if this is actually true, but it's a nice story and I like to imagine Albert Einstein talking. So bear with me even if it's not absolutely correct. Okay, apparently Albert Einstein once was walking through the forest, he liked to take walks, was walking through the forest with one of his colleagues, yeah? And they were just talking about, you know, science. And his colleague said, can you imagine how arrogant and stupid and ignorant the people must have been back in the day, in the times of the geocentric worldview, that they thought that the sun revolves around the earth? How arrogant. And apparently Albert Einstein said, yes, you're right. Very arrogant and very stupid. But I do wonder, what would it have looked like if they would have been right? What would it have looked like if they would have been right? Yeah? We observe the phenomena around us and our assumptions and beliefs make us interpret them in a certain way. Okay? They lead to the answers we give to these questions. So, I said to you, I want to talk about the future of humanity and the meaning of life. If I take these questions and I apply these questions to ourselves, to the question, what does it mean to be human? What's our context? What does it mean to be humanity? What's our context on this planet? Okay? If I ask, what are we? What's around us? And what's our position around us? Okay? That's the question we need to answer if we want to work out what the future of us is going to be going forward. Right? And in asking these questions, what I need to do is I need to look at, first, where do we stand right now? Yeah? And I need to look at the assumptions we have made in the past 200-300 years on these levels. First, on the question, what's around me? the assumptions around our environment. Since the Industrial Revolution with the invention of the machine, we overcame our physical limitations and we overcame the dictatorship of nature. In other words, we overtook nature, we conquered nature, we became the masters of nature. And with that, the planet Earth became nothing but a pool of resources for us to draw from. Planet Earth is subject to human reality, not the other way around. Okay? On the question of what's around me. On the question of who am I and what am I? Yeah? With René Descartes, who defined for us, I think, therefore I am. Okay? We reduce the human being to his intellect, his rationality. Okay? I am my mind. And what distinguishes me from the rest of life on this world is that I have a mind. And what makes me conscious and sentient is my rational, logical mind. Okay? So this creates the understanding of ourselves as rational creatures first, and it separates us from all of the other creatures of which we do not believe to be rational and logical. And on the question of what's my position and where can I sit and how can I relate, well, we have in the last 300 years defined our relatedness to our environment through separation. In our economic reality, we defined ourselves through separation from one another as we are pursuing scarce resources in competition against one another. On a social and political level, we define ourselves and our relatedness to separation on the basis of ethnicities. You're different from me, I'm different from you, and on the basis of nation states. My country, your country. Yeah? And the only places of relatedness in the system really are through economic exchange, transaction. Okay? So, what then does it mean to be human, or what did it mean to be human in the 20th century? What has it meant to be human for the last 300 years? What it meant to be human for the last 300 years was we created an economy, a system that focuses its productive efforts, into the conversion of natural resources into consumable goods for one another. The entire productive effort of our economy is focused on the conversion of natural resources into products for consumption. Okay? What it means to be human in the 20th century, it means that I, as an individual, am a rational creature that rationally seeks out the maximum pleasure and benefit for myself. Yeah? Through the consumption of these products that are being created. Yeah? This idea of the homo economicus. That's the idea of the human being of the last 200-300 years. And what it means to be human in a collective is that we organize ourselves in our schools, in our education, in our nations, in our companies, in order to drive this economic machine and this purpose of maximization of material consumption in one lifetime. Okay? How does that sound to you? Sounds like a cool life, isn't it? Yeah. Now, I said I want to talk to you about the future of humanity and the meaning of life. Why now? Why right now? Because actually, times are changing. We know that times are changing. We talk about digitalization, networkification, artificial intelligence, robotics, quantum computing, all of these technological evolutions. Yeah? These times out there. And they're real. I would argue we should use these times also to reconsider what it means to be human. Why? Because all these changes are already pushing into our understanding, our definition. They're putting the mirror up and showing us actually what we seem to be thinking doesn't seem to quite work out, what we have been thinking for the last 300 years. What do I mean by that? Let's look at it from an economic point, from an environmental point of view. We thought planet Earth is subsequent to us. It's embedded into human reality. Now we have global warming coming up. We had 36 degrees a day for, I think, 2 months, every day in Berlin. In Berlin, imagine. Yeah? We're not talking about the Adriatic coast. We're talking about Berlin. We have global warming there, and you know what it does? It's reminding us, no, wait a minute. Not Earth is embedded into your system. You are embedded into Earth. Earth sustains us, not the other way around. So that is challenging our understanding of we have conquered nature. No, we have not conquered nature. Okay? We have not conquered nature. Nature is still our boss. Okay? Secondly, in terms of relatedness, We see an economy emerging that many call the network economy, an economy based on collaboration, an economy based on contribution, an economy that challenges the notion that we have to compete with each other in order to create wealth for one another. Yeah? An economy that challenges the notion that wealth and value is only in material resources. Because this new economy is showing us that is shifting actually the value from assets and resources and the machines into the connections that we make with one another. Yeah? I love the example of Uber or Airbnb, two of the leading companies in their field. How many cars does Uber own? Zero, right? One of the leading mobility providers on this planet. Because the value is shifting into the connections. We have it on that side, on the economic side. And we also have migrant movements around the world right now, whether that's war in Syria or global warming in the southern hemisphere pushing people up, which is also challenging our notion of an identity through nation and ethnicity. Yeah? And it's challenging our notion of what happens here relates to me and over there it doesn't. Yeah, we've been bombing, not you, not us, but us, yes, my nation, yes. We've been bombing a country and now we wonder that the people are coming here. Yeah? That's challenging our notion there. And lastly, the rise of AI, of artificial intelligence, is challenging our notion of intelligence and sentience being defined by rationality and logical analytical thinking. We have already lost the race for logical analytical thinking. Artificial intelligence is more logical, more analytical, more rational, and faster than we are. So it's challenging our definition. I think, therefore I am. There's even a movement in the US that talks about those technophiles that believe that actually artificial intelligence is here to surpass us and take over this planet. They speak of a biocentric bias on sentience. What does that mean? The bias to believe that only biological life is alive. Yeah? We are challenged in the question, what makes us human? Because if it's just our rationality, computers are more human than we are. Okay? So, I look at these times of change, and for some it could spell crisis. For those of us who love the last 300 years and want to hold on to the worldview, okay? For those of us who seek the truth and who want to get rid of the illusions that limit our radius of perception and awareness, it's actually a time of opportunity. It's a time of opportunity to rethink, to reconsider what it means to be human on this planet and what it means to be a human family on this planet. It's an opportunity to rethink this. As we are pondering where we can apply blockchain, as we are pondering what beautiful things we can let artificial intelligence do for us, as we are pondering whether Elon Musk is going to send us up to Mars or not, we can also now use the opportunity to ask ourselves, wait a minute, what are we doing all of this for actually? Why? Yeah? What for? With what aim? And I want to propose to you three ideas, three perspectives to internalize into your perspective and see what it does to your questions as to why and how and where we are and what we do. Okay? Three simple perspectives. Yeah? Number one, a perspective on the self. If you thought you are a rational being and only due to your rationality you are being, I ask you to reconsider. You have also a body, and your body has an intelligence. Science shows us more and more how our rationality, our mind, is number one, not rational, and number two, competing with a whole bunch of other intelligences within ourselves. Our emotions, our intuition. Once upon a time, we considered it esoteric. Now that's interesting science at the frontier of science. So, my first invitation to you, you are more than just the mind. You are a body also. And because you are a body also, you are not separate from planet Earth, because your body is the animal that is connected to this planet Earth. Which brings me to the second point, the aspect of relatedness. We are not separate from the plant life of this planet. We are not separate from the animal life on this planet. It's not my life that flows, that moves around. It's life that moves through this planet and owns me in this form. Okay? We are not separate. Yeah? We also are learning in science. We are not separate from our ancestors. Studies show that the children of Holocaust survivors and their grandchildren actually show in the DNA marker and in the psychological and physical makeup, they show wounds of their great-grandparents in the past. To 2-3 generations later down the line. So we are connected intimately, physically to our ancestral line. Okay? Yeah? We are also not separate in terms of our nations and ethnicities. Yeah? If we look at human migration over the last 75,000 years, 250,000 years, we all probably come from the same space. And we all have mixed and mingled for a long, long time. So to draw the lines of separation is artificial and in a way is ignorant. Okay? And when it comes to the environment, as I mentioned to you, the global warming and the climate change as such is reminding us that we are not, the planet is not only subject to us, but we are subject to the planet. And here again, I want to invite us as humanity as a whole to think we are not separate from planet Earth. We are nature. When we say, I want to be in nature, not in our cities are nature. Our cities are nature, the human beehives. Okay? Yeah? And I'm telling you this also because I want you to realize that our planet is our home, but its boundaries, this is another invitation to you, its boundaries are not the boundaries of life as such. They are just the front door to our front yard, to the great next frontier, which is our solar system and our galaxy. Yes. Okay? So, why am I suggesting all of this? I'm suggesting this because I want to tell you, you can cultivate this perspective. And if we cultivate this perspective in the 21st century, maybe we have a chance to transcend the malaise, the illnesses of the last 300 years. And maybe we have an ability and a chance to transcend our limited existence over these last 300 years and move into something that I would call a planetary age, a planetary society, a society where we ascend, metaphorically speaking, and literally speaking. What do I mean by that? Metaphorically speaking, a society where we recognize that we are not separated, that our commonalities are more pronounced than our separations, where we unite, where we no longer go into competition with one another, trying to take away from one another, but go into contribution with one another and contribute to each other. Unite on planet Earth, metaphorically speaking, rise up to become the shepherds of the other life that flows through this planet, and literally speaking, as this unit then rise up to the next great frontier and start to explore our front yard, which is become an interplanetary species in our solar system and hopefully even in our galaxy. Okay? I'm telling you this, I'm making a big claim, but I want to tell you something someone told me last night, a friend of mine, an Arabic proverb he told me. He said, when you see something that you can change, change it with your hands. When you cannot change it with your hands, change it with your words. When you cannot change it with your words, change it in your heart. So I want to invite you all to make that change in your heart and see where it takes us as a collective. Thank you very much.